garden party to reminisce with my old friends. A chance to share old memories and play our songs again. When I got to the garden party, they all knew my name. No one recognized me. I didn't look the same, but it's all right now. I learned my lesson well. You see, you can't please everyone, so you got to please yourself.
All right, 5 minutes after 9 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in this Tuesday morning. That music and the fact that it's Tuesday means Carolyn Baldwin is somewhere nearby. She's here to answer your questions about your lawns and your gardens, and maybe the weather right now is going to play a big role in what she says. I don't know. We'll find out together. Good morning, Carolyn. How are you doing?
Good morning, Larry. How are you?
And the phone number to call Carolyn, let me mention this real quickly, if you don't know, is 622-9622-622-WOCA. That is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline. Now, good morning.
There we go. Good morning again.
I think I'm the last one to get this cold.
Well, don't you pass it any further.
Don't worry, I got barriers.
Screen.
You see,
yeah,
see all these things I have?
Yeah.
I'm the only one with these barriers.
With a little Lysol that way. I knock wood. I have not yet been healed this winter. And
I thought you had
it. Keep it that way. No.
Oh, you didn't have
Mm-mm.
it.
Well, no, it's no.
Don't touch your eyes.
Has not gone through our family yet. No, it's lots of hand washing and yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, lots of vitamins.
It's very hard for me to not touch my eyes.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
I'm very much the same, and it's so I do wash my hands a lot, and I actually rinse my face off often. Help keep the germs away. That and the pollens, too, because I do have a little seasonal allergy, and this time of year, it's one of those things that, you know, your eyes get itching, so what are you doing? You got your fingers in your eyes. You know,
yeah, but see, did you hear how Bob Costas got the pink eye? You know, Bob Costas, the sports
right, right, right.
He's in Sochi.
Heard, right.
Well, their water isn't good for washing your face.
Right.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. So, you know, just wash your face with vodka if you're over there. It's cleaner than the water.
Bring yourself a bunch of wet wipes. But that's, yeah, a whole nother stuff. But no, hopefully everybody's doing good out there. It's beautiful out.
It really is nice. It really is nice.
Yesterday was wonderful. Today, the whole rest of the week's supposed to be nice. I guess some rain this weekend maybe or something. That's what I was
My banana plant has a big, gigantic green thing coming out of it.
Out of
it
the
hasn't
top
unfurled
of it.
Yet, yeah, but it's sticking
the
up.
Cone,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
The cone
yeah.
coming out. Yeah, everything's trying to pop up. Let's all hope that we don't get another bad cold snap. You know, we'll have some seasonal cool, like this week's the lows overnight are in the 40s to low 50s, which is good. And if you're looking around, you see all the trees, all the buds are swelling, red buds are beginning to bloom, the dogwoods won't be far behind. You know, just if you look up, if you have trees in your yard, look up, you're seeing those buds swell.
Yes, I've seen the trees,
yeah.
the buds, yeah.
Yeah, and it's
kind
they're
of cool.
Starting. Yeah, they're starting. We're getting ready to
pop. See, I want to send photos to the people up north.
Right.
Say,
yeah, they keep posting pictures of snow. And
springtime
here.
Stop. I got oranges on my tree.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, little ones starting already?
No, the orange.
The ones
that haven't fallen off yet.
Right, time to get them all picked off, really. It's.
Well, usually there's a neighborhood lady who does that.
Who goes through and culls off the end of the fruit.
Well, she does something with them, and I'd rather she take them than they just fall off.
Sure. Well, that's it. If you've got trees in your yard, if you've been eating your citrus, you'll notice that the buds are starting to form. There's new growth beginning to come on them. I would probably work on getting the end of that fruit off over the next couple weeks, just so that the tree's not trying to hold on to them at the same time as trying to put on this year's new growth.
Really? Maybe I should do that, then.
Yeah, it's just over the next couple weeks.
Fill baskets and stuff and hand them out.
Yeah, hand them out. Share them. Juice them.
They're not bad tasting.
You can freeze juice. You know, for use later on, you got your own fresh squeezed orange juice or grapefruit juice. If you are on certain, I believe, blood pressure medications, be careful with the grapefruit.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
I never heard that.
Yeah, there's a tie that you don't want.
Huh.
Them together. I'm not sure if you have to avoid it all together, but I don't. Yeah, that I don't know. I'm not a doctor nor pharmacist. I'm a gardener. But yeah, because your trees, and you're going to start to fertilize those also. That right now, between now and the 1st of March, we usually say February, June, and September gives you a good time frame on your citrus to get that going. And that's why I said, you know, here by the 1st of March or so, if you can get all that fruit off the trees are going to be a little happier. Cut off any of the dead wood in there. If you have to do any pruning, realize whatever you cut off is going to be next year's fruit. But that's okay. If it has gotten too big and you have to reduce the size of the tree this year, okay, you may not get as many fruit, but next year you should benefit from it in the long run, that it'll put on new growth. It should be a little happier, a little healthier. I did a little reading on the citrus greening recently as well, is that they've said, greening is widespread. It may be in every bit of citrus around. It's more than likely it's in every grove in Central Florida, seeing the map of the citrus industry and in those counties, and the way it stretches up is that, and there's a good chance greening's everywhere, but there's one grower who's been doing some research, and it seems to be working of intensifying nutrition on these trees, as well as a program of trying to keep the psyllid, the insect that's the vectoring agent of the citrus greening. And he's been using like the liquid foliar nutrition sprays as well as the regular fertilizer routine. So if you've had some trees that may be struggling, it does seem to help them fight it off, maybe like with a cold or flu, we take a little extra.
You have a producer who's struggling right now.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, that's why I keep trying to keep going.
you're doing good. Forgive the lozenge.
No, with the citrus greening, it's something, and that's while they're still working on some bio controls as well as trying to find, I believe they have found the DNA strand of what the greening is, and now they're trying to figure out where it's linked within the citrus tree itself that causes the disease. So it will, if they can figure that out, they can do, you would almost call it, my way of trying to figure it is almost like a stem cell research kind of thing, or possibly, yes, the dreaded three-letter word everybody hates to hear is a GMO, is, but if you can turn off that gene in the strand in the citrus and or change that strand to where it's no longer susceptible to that, they can eliminate, you know, that issue, which is a benefit because we, you know, the citrus industry in Florida, all across the Texas, I believe New Mexico, Arizona, California, these states all have this problem. Brazil has it, the rest of South America, Asia. You know, we really don't need citrus to go away. But I said I may drop an email to one of these people because I have some seed growing. They grew from seed. You know, kind of thing, you're eating an orange, you spit the seed out.
Right.
Eventually the little tree grows. 15 years later, it's fruiting. These trees they don't get fertilized. They're in the woods.
Uh-huh.
They fruit. They have good fruit.
Really?
And
not sour.
There's not sour fruit because citrus will grow true from seed. They graft citrus trees so that they fruit earlier, and generally it's for a hardiness of the rootstock. But these citrus trees, they're both grapefruit and orange. Which ones, I don't know. Probably a marsh grapefruit. The orange, I'm not sure. I'd have to sit down with the book and cut one in half and try to look it up. But they don't seem to be bothered by pests.
You may have discovered something.
It could be that we need to go back to something else. That or it's that because they're growing in the woods, there's other things that they just, the pest does not find them, possibly.
That's pretty cool.
But I've got four or five trees just growing kind of wild in our
woods. And you remember spitting the seeds out 15 years ago?
No, I don't really remember spitting them out, but it's like, okay, you know, you probably, we tossed them out for the birds or whatever, and, you know. They grew, and
that is cool.
But they're not bothered by
somebody needs to look into that, or
it's a
you should look into
thought,
it and publish a report and
Become rich and famous. Yeah,
get something out
of it. We all know researchers don't make money. But it's just something to think about. You know, a little stronger maybe on the nutrition. Make sure you're fertilizing your citrus trees to try to keep them as healthy as possible. Just like they say with people, you know, if you keep yourself, if you eat right, plenty of water,
make sure you take some
vitamins, get some sunshine, this and that, that it helps to either ward off illness, you know, not every illness, or help to, you know, recover from it a little better. Stay hydrated.
Thank you. I'm trying my hardest.
We're trying.
I don't think lozenges are considered a natural food. By the way, have I ever asked you this?
Well, do you have Ricolas? Now, those would be a...
Ricola.
Yeah, there you go. Should have brought you some in.
I got these ones. What are they called? Halls.
Yeah.
Did I ever ask you this? And is it just a dumb question? Why is it called greening? Is there something turning green?
It's that the fruit actually does sort of revert to a green, even though the tree will yellow. The telltale signs are the mottled greening. It actually comes from, and I don't have the Chinese word in front of me, but it translates into the green dragon.
Oh, really?
And then we turned it into, yeah, the citrus greening.
Well, I like green dragon better.
Green dragon. Yeah, we got the green dragon disease. Yeah, it just sounds like something you should put something topical on, but I don't know. But that's one of the, you know, reasons that, you know, the university and other growers don't really recommend planting citrus in the landscape, but I, you know, it's not going to harm the industry any further, and all your citrus, the rootstock and things like that are all grown in greenhouses. If it's sold on the market, they've got tags, they've been treated to try to prevent it using systemic insecticides, and you know, it's one of those things of trying to, you know, that so that when the homeowner buys it, at least he's not buying a plant that's already got the problem, already has greening started. And then it's just after that of trying to keep that plant healthy and going with insect control.
Robin put a picture of, I think, bamboo on her
yeah,
Facebook
yeah,
page.
Yeah, the rush.
Do you remember
yeah,
that?
Yeah, the horsetail.
And it was from Kanapaha?
Kanapaha. Right.
I want to ask you about it. Let me look for it real quickly. I remember she was telling me about it.
Yeah, she had called it a horsetail bamboo, but it's actually, I believe, within the rush family, R-U-S-H, just some, you know, something like that, horsetail rush. It spreads. It's a cool plant. It really is a kind of a clumping.
But it looks like bamboo. I'm looking at that.
It sort of does look like a bamboo, but I think it's more, well, bamboo is a grass too, but it's...
what she's saying to you here, she said she got the word horsetail from the label itself.
Right.
Okay, maybe she forgot to write down the other part of it.
No, she had.
Or maybe it just said horsetail. Maybe
it may have said horsetail, and she just thought bamboo because you think of Kanapaha, you think of the bamboos.
But it looks like bamboo.
And I guess they may be related in a way. Bamboos and your rushes. Did I bring that book in? Yeah. see what I brought in with me today.
If I didn't know any better, it looks like bamboo.
It does somewhat, but it's not as big.
You remember the picture, right?
Yeah. And that one. That still looks like the regular rush. Let me see if I can.
So rush and bamboo are two different things, but they look the same.
They can look the same.
So why is it called horsetail? Where's that name come from?
Just the way it.
Does it look like a horse's tail? Not to me.
I don't think it does. But
no, not to me either.
No. To some people, whoever named it.
By the way, Kanapaha, isn't that a pretty cool place? If you've never gone there. I've only gone once because you guys have talked about it forever, you and Suzanne. And I went one time. I was like, wow, this is awesome.
It's a botanical garden. And
there's plenty of bamboo in the entrance.
Oh, they and they have their bamboo sale. Oh, shoot, I thought I saw an email on that recently, and I'm not sure
on
when
Kanapaha?
They have that. Yeah, because I know, the season on all the garden shows and such is starting up. Usually it starts with the Master Gardener Spring Festival there on that second, March 8th and 9th. And then all the rest of them begin to come in afterwards. I may have to try to look it up. in another using the smartphone.
While you're looking up, I can use my voice while I have it. The phone number, if you'd like to call Carolyn, is 622-9622. That is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline. My banana plant growing very rapidly. I'm wondering if it's the fastest growing plant.
Well, it's the biggest herb, so it could be the fastest.
Really? I heard that bamboo is very fast too, right?
It is very fast growing. Yes, it is. I'm trying to remember my alphabet as I'm flipping pages here. Here we go. I just found it. Horsetail. It's actually the botanical is Equestum.
There's a horse
higher male.
What?
Equestum. Mm-hmm. Equisetum.
Yeah.
And then the second part of the word, or the second word, is Hymale, H-Y-E-M-A-L-E, Hymale,
okay.
Something, horsetail, equestrian, perennial, full sun, part shade, marshy area or pool, survivor of the carboniferous age in Europe and North America. North America has several species, slender, hollow, four-foot stems are bright green, showing a ring of black and ash gray at each joint. So if you're looking at the picture,
let's go back to that picture.
And born in cone-like spikes at stem ends.
Sure does have that, yeah.
Miniature is only 6 to 8 inches high. Common name horsetail refers to the bushy look produced by many of whorls of slender jointed green stems that radiate out from the joints of the main stems on some of the other species. Although horsetail is effective in some garden situations, especially near water, use it with caution. I was going to mention this. Extremely invasive and difficult to get rid of.
Really?
But confined to containers, put it in. If you really want it, you have a pond. It really is pretty within a pond location. Put it in a big pot. Put the whole pot in the ground. And that's the way to do it.
So in Canaba, how do they contain it? How do they contain
it? It may be in a large container
underground.
Oh, really? It could be. They may have something down underground that's a barrier to try to keep it from going elsewhere. But in open ground, be sure to root prune or dig out unwanted shoots rigorously and consistently or constantly. Constantly.
An unsolicited promotion for Canaba High. It really is. It's worth the trip.
And they have several events each year. Like I said, after the Master Gardener ones, I want to say it's like 2 weeks later is Canaba High. Somebody will probably set me straight. But all of the different events are coming up, all the different garden clubs, big events. And
what
things.
Is the park up in Georgia? Just over the state line, there's a park up there.
The Swamp Okie Finoki?
No, not on the east. It's more to the west side. Oh, boy, what is that called again? There's another park up there that I've always wanted to go to.
My brain's going
to... So we went to the Canaba, huh? Uh-huh. We went to the one in Palatka, which is called Ravine Gardens, mm-hmm. which is another awesome place to go to. That's amazing, really.
Yeah.
And that ravine get formed? I think I was told, but I forget.
I'm not sure on that.
But anyway... Yeah. There's some really cool things we can go to right in our own backyard.
We do. We have some wonderful
garden
places.
Related.
Yeah. I mean, you got Rainbow Springs State Park.
Beautiful. And now Silver Springs, right?
And now Silver Springs. And
Callaway Gardens. Thank you, Robin.
Ah, there you
Callaway
go.
Callaway Gardens.
Okay, yeah. Then you get down to Orlando, you got Lou Gardens and things like that.
And
Bock Towers.
Thank you.
Yeah, you got Bock Towers. So,
we really do have a lot.
We're coming up into some gorgeous weather. Take a day trip. And most of these places are
camera.
Not that far. And take your camera. Take a little picnic lunch and take a
walk. Oh, that sounds like a good idea, doesn't it?
Yeah. Unfortunately, I have to do my taxes. I'm off today, but I got so many things I have to do.
Man, I got jury duty on Monday, too.
Oh, fun. Good luck.
Hope I'm done on Monday. Hope I'm there, and they say, oh, you? Get out of here. We don't want you.
Yeah, we
do. All right, good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Good morning.
Morning.
How are you? Good morning.
Great. How are you?
I'm great. Blue Gardens is a fabulous garden to go to, and they have a sale. I believe it's in April.
Uh-huh.
You can look it up. They have a web page and all that. It's a fabulous garden. Robert Bowden is the best curator around.
Yeah.
Also, I just wanted to know if you have shorts on today.
Not today. I had one yet, but I'm off today, so when I go home, I can put shorts on. So yesterday I wore shorts to work, and I got to work and I went, my knees are cold. So, but it warmed up.
I got I've still got two layers on, so I'm in and out, and it's cold. So hopefully it'll warm up soon.
Oh, it will. It'll be warm by lunchtime. I actually took off all my jackets earlier. So.
You know, I have one already, so I'm working on it.
There you go. It's 51 degrees.
Woohoo!
It's getting up there. It's getting up there. It's 51, so we'll make it.
Right. You guys have a fabulous day.
You too, Sharon.
We'll talk
to you soon.
Yes.
Bye. Bye-bye.
But have you noticed we're kind of getting used to it? It's like it said 46 the other day, and
right.
You know, back a few months ago, I would have said, oh, man, it's so cold out there.
Yeah, that's right. Once you get accustomed, and you know what? And that too, is the same thing that happens with our plants, and that might be why we haven't gotten too much real serious cold damage, is that we've gotten cold and we didn't really warm up a whole lot in between on those, or we didn't get a chance to warm up for an extended period. It wasn't like we would drop down to those really cold nights and cold days for 3 or 4 days and then warm up for 2-3 weeks. It was, we dropped down, we'd warm up a little bit and drop back down, warm up a little bit. So we had that real tight cycle, and we're going to hope, I'm hoping that we're done with that really cold weather. That we're coming into that upper mid 40s, low 50s for the overnights. And I mean, that's still chilly, but it is technically still winter time. Yes, it is Florida, but technically still winter. And I have on Master Gardener Spring Festival gotten there on Saturday morning wearing 2 and 3 coats and a hood on and going, oh dear Lord, we're going to freeze. Nobody's going to come out. By the midday, it's warm, it's sunny, still
quickly,
windy,
yeah.
And so it those cold mornings just make you appreciate those warm afternoons a little more. We are coming up. I wanted to get to something, if hopefully the listener did, just to get onto something else, but it's timely that we're looking at our turf grasses and things like that. A couple weeks ago, somebody had questioned Bermuda grass for Florida, and I know that the seed companies, a couple of them in the stores, you can buy Bermuda grass seed. They advertise it as tough, you know, grass and such like that. But my thing had always been, it's not necessarily the best grass for Florida. It is, I'll go through. This is Bermuda grass for Florida lawns. It came out of the Florida Lawn Handbook through the University of Florida. And Bermuda grass is also called wire grass or devil grass. They are planted throughout Florida on primarily golf courses, athletic fields, tennis courts, and bowling greens. They're primarily used in areas where fine textured, high quality turf is essential for sports activities and maintenance budgets are adequate. It's native to Africa, thrived in fertile soils. Today, most of the Bermuda grasses used for Florida turf are hybrids of two different kinds. Advantages of the Bermuda grass is a vigorous, light to dark green, dense turf, well adapted to most soils and climatic regions of Florida. Excellent wear, drought, and salt tolerance, good choice for ocean front. Establishes rapidly and is competitive against weeds, and depending on the variety available in seeds, you're not going to find sod and sprigs around. You're going to find seed usually for us. At least I've not. Maybe if you went to a sod grower, you'd find it. Disadvantage, and of course the advantage is, I have one paragraph. Disadvantages,
oh, yeah.
There's
difference.
Two. It's at least double. Large number of cultural and pest problems, which restricts its use on many Florida situations. It's not suitable for most home lawns because of the need of restricted use pesticides to control nematodes and insects. That's so if you have a problem, you can't afford to fix it usually. It requires the most maintenance for an acceptable appearance of any turf grass. In central and north Florida, Bermuda grass becomes dormant, turns brown and cold. Usually people will overseed with winter rye to keep green in the wintertime. Bermuda grasses are susceptible to several nematode, insect, and disease problems. Poor shade tolerance, should not be grown underneath tree canopies or building overhangs. It spreads very rapidly, and both the varieties have above-ground stolons and below-ground rhizomes or runners, which are very difficult to control within flower beds, walks, and borders. So it gets out of the lawn area into your flower beds across the sidewalk. Due to its rapid growth nature, thatch buildup can become a problem in Bermuda, and a real mower should also be used to mow it for its best mowing. And, you know, the real mowers, most of those, I think there are some that are a little bit powered now, but it's not really recommended for this area. And I know I've seen lots and lots of people pick up those jugs, juggo seed. It'll grow nearly anywhere. Yeah, and then it becomes a weed. Yeah, juggo seed.
Carolyn.
It's not real expensive, but it actually is. If when you look at that bottle of seed that you pay $30 for and you realize it's only covering 150 square feet and it's not going to match the turf you already have, and it may overtake the turf you already have. So might be something to think about before you.
It's one of those things you ask a question before you buy it, right? You find somebody who knows.
But even still, to know that, I mean, and this is, this information, it is, I'm sure you can find it on the University of Florida's website. Like I said, this came out of the Florida Lawn Handbook, which I'm pretty sure that was a very recent, one, but it doesn't matter. The advantages and disadvantages are still the same, that it's, real aggressive. Is know what you're getting. Up north they have weed killers for your lawn that are for Bermuda grass. See, here, if we try to use a product like that, it'll kill our other grasses. Because our grasses are susceptible. Ask questions. Because I had somebody where there was an ad campaign for products. It was a national ad campaign. And next thing you know, everybody's asking for the product. How do I get this weed control for Bermuda, to control the Bermuda grass in the lawn? So, you can't buy it in Florida because it'll kill the Florida grasses. Huh. You can buy it in Georgia, but you can't buy it in Florida. Because it's not, and basically when you can't buy it in the state, there's a reason.
So that's a good rule of thumb then. Yeah. If it's prohibited by somebody in your state, then chances are it's not going to be good for you.
Right.
Or your lawn,
right.
Whatever.
Yeah, but trying to explain that because everybody wanted that right, product right. Because they wanted to be able to kill the Bermuda grass that was in their lawn, and you can't,
Or if they don't know, they right. say to their brother-in-law up in Georgia, hey, I hear about this. Oh, I got it in my store. I'll send
it to
you.
Yeah, I get it. Yeah, and next time I come down, I'll bring you a jug of it. Or, hey, when you come up, we got it right here at the big box store next door. And, but, read the labels. I believe it can be used on zoysia, but then again, the zoysia we have may be a different variety and may not quite react as well. Read, follow the label instructions. You can even buy it online, probably, but I don't think they're actually allowed to ship it into Florida just because it's not labeled
for
use.
Can I interview you? There's a one-question interview.
Uh-oh.
I'm just going to interview one question.
One question.
How did your gardening vocabulary become so big? How do you know so many... I need a glossary sometimes listening to you.
Just from books.
Just from one little word at a time, huh?
One word at a time, yeah. You pick up on something, and when you use it over and over again, it becomes part of
You don't even realize how big, if you were to write them all down, you probably could write a gardening dictionary or something.
On some of them, right. It is just from the constant exposure.
And it's not just the words and their meanings, but their pronunciations.
On some of
I think I've seen the word zoysia printed. I don't think it looks like
that. Z-O-Y-S-I-A, zoysia. Zoysia,
maybe that's not
Bahia,
the word.
Zoysia is one of those ones.
Bahia looks like Bahia, doesn't it?
Right, Bahia. Some people say Bahia. Okay. And some people call St. Augustine St. Augustine.
Oh, really? But that's close. That doesn't sound
it's,
that far.
Bahia. Same thing, centipede. Well, that looks like centipede. But
so the answer to the question, how you had such a vast vocabulary with gardening
constant use is all it is. That, you're just anybody. I mean, now probably if we got talking the technical side of radio, you would blow me away with
I
words. I have
that.
No idea what they are. But,
I don't know about thank you for trying to make me feel good.
On the technical side,
I don't know.
I mean, to
I don't
me,
know
it's
that
buttons
I know
and dials.
Oh, my goodness.
But,
well, thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Trying to make everybody, pat everybody on the back. Yeah, you do a good job, too.
But I guess the follow-up question would be, Well, first of all, would there be such a dictionary for gardening terms?
There's glossaries of terms in
the back of each book, right?
In the back of each books and things like that. The usually if you find, you know, a book on botany, they're going to give you the glossary of terms used within botany. Some of the words, I guess, I use come from not just the plant side, you know, that I like to grow vegetables. I like to grow some flowers, but I like to grow vegetables mostly myself. So some of it comes from there. I've worked with flowers, plants, trees, shrubs. So I've worked directly with them, both pruning them, potting them, selling them, merchandising them. I've also worked with garden chemicals, you know, and lawn chemicals and things like that. And so it's just the three and four things all mashed up together,
so,
I guess.
So here's a question I've always wondered. And these are three words. Okay. Is there a difference between a bush, a shrub, and a hedge? What the heck is the difference between the three?
A bush would stand alone.
But it could be.
But okay. A shrub, but a hedge line, a hedge is a continuous.
A hedge is a group of bushes.
Is a group of bushes or shrubs. That they're, bushes and shrubs are pretty much the same.
This is like trying to explain to me what a schnitzel is. I've asked this question. Nobody answers the same way.
You know, gesundheit.
So a hedge is.
A hedge would be a continuous row for
of
privacy
any plant,
of any plant.
Any plant
going through.
You can have a hedge of roses.
Yes, especially because it would be a rose bush. Would so, make a hedge, yeah.
That'd be a pretty hedge, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would. And people do use it that way many times. Here you've got a line of Indian hawthorn, I think, are over there on the front. And that's sort of a hedging. But then the big hollies in the middle, that's a large shrub. That wouldn't be a bush. I guess a shrub, you're going taller.
But not
because
as tall
a shrub
as a tree.
Would stand alone. Sometimes.
Does it become something else? Does a shrub become a tree?
It can, if you train it that
way. What's a camellia again?
A camellia is a camellia bush if you leave it with all of its
bushiness.
Right. And then if you prune it up into a tree form, you have a tree formed or standardized.
Okay.
See, they can take in standard. That's another one of those terminologies if you're looking for. You can buy a bottle brush. Bush, and you can buy a bottle brush tree. The bottle brush bush is just that. It's a bushy little plant that it's going to grow up to be a very big bushy plant. A bottle brush tree is one where a central leader, a central stem, has been selected when it was real little, and it's been trained up into a trunk like a tree, and all of its growth is on top. They do the same thing with hibiscus. Now, the rose trees usually are grafted onto a host one just so that they can get the right.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you know, they'll put three pieces
really?
On there, and then you've got your your rose tree. And it's just
well,
a lot of different ways of doing.
We went too long a little bit. We need to take a little break.
Take a break,
and
yeah.
We'll be right back. If you have a question for Carol Ann or just want to chat with Carol Ann, the number is 622-9622. That's the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline. If you call right now, you'll be on hold for about 2.5 minutes. We'll be right back.
Phoenix Promotional Solutions, your company supplier of banners, digital decals, yard signs, and magnetic signs. Where you give them approved artwork by noon, the next day by 4 p.m., you pick up your banners, digital decals, yard signs, and magnetic signs. Phoenix Promotional Solutions, 368-2404. That's 368-2404. Don't forget, they do vehicle wraps also. Phoenix Promotional Solutions, 368-2404.
Did you know that Marion County has a vast equine business? Tune in every Friday at 9:30 for Horse Sense, when we connect, communicate, and educate you on ways to participate in and enjoy all the equine adventures this area has to offer.
Sponsored in part by Infinite Day Spa, Almara Arabian Horses, and Florida Thoroughbred Breeders Owners Association, FTBOA.
Fridays at 9:30, right here on The Source.
I'm a different breed. Habitat for Humanity of Marion County is a ministry dedicated to improving lives by providing affordable and decent housing. Help them help others by visiting the Habitat for Humanity Ocala Restore at 926 Northwest 27th Avenue. To schedule a donation, give us a call at 401-0075 and we'll come pick it up. For more information, visit ocalarestore.org. Habitat for Humanity of Marion County. Building homes, building hope, building community.
Beautiful Moments Party Rentals presents Showcase Under the Stars, a bridal affair to remember. This event has it all. Caterers, photographers, florists, DJs, venues, and more. All gathered in one place and all there to help you plan your special day. Brides, bring your bridesmaids and friends alike. This is the event you don't want to miss. There will be food, fun, trivia games, and prizes with different wedding-themed areas to explore. Tickets are only $10, and Beautiful Moments Party Rentals is donating 100% to the United Way of Marion County. Advance tickets can be purchased at Beautiful Moments Party Rentals, 3400 Southwest 60th Avenue in Ocala. Showcase Under the Stars takes place on March 13th from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m., so make plans to be there. Again, that's March 13th at Beautiful Moments Party Rentals from 5 to 9 p.m. If you have any questions, just give them a call, 307-8180. That's 307-8180. And make your plans to attend the Showcase Under the Stars. Showcase Under the
Stars. All right, 20 minutes before 10 o'clock. Let's return to Carol Ann Baldwin, and You've Got a Garden. If you have a question, remember the phone lines are open. You're invited to call. The number is 622-WOCA, the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline.
There you go. Got those mark your calendar kind of things, and I just wanted to give everybody a heads up. It's, of course, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday this week is when these are all scheduled. Tomorrow from 2 to 3 p.m. at the Dunellen Library. So if you're over there near the Dunellen area, they have the Master Gardeners are going to be out there doing a program on vegetable gardening, the how-to of beginning your spring vegetable garden from 2 to 3 o'clock tomorrow afternoon at the Dunellen Public Library. On Thursday, the 20th, Marion Oaks Library is going to have, this should have been last week, really, it's going to have Stages of Human Romance as Told by Florida Flowers. So remember, we had that list Language of Flowers. Well, this is Stages of Human Romance as Told by Florida Flowers. I guess, yeah, hey, get the information. You can use it all year long to romance your loved one. And
or not.
That, or not. That's Thursday from 10:30 to 11:30 at Marion Oaks Public Library. On Friday at 11 a.m. is Master the Possibilities series at the On Top of the World. And I'm not sure, and I don't even have the phone number to them, if you need to call over there in advance or not, but it's at the Master of the Possibilities Education Center on Top of the World, and it's growing vegetables in containers. If you have any questions on any of those, call over to the Extension Office, 671-8400. And also the Master Gardener Spring Festival. We'll keep talking about this till the time comes and it goes. Keep your eye out for the flyers, March 8th and 9th over at the, I call it the Livestock Pavilion property, but it's back behind the Livestock Pavilion adjacent to the Extension Office gardens, which will all be cleaned up and all looking real pretty for everything. You can look online, MarionCountyFL.org/Spring Festival, and you should be able to bring that up. There's also, if you've run into one of the flyers around town, or it might even end up in the paper, there's a QR code you can scan for your phone.
Oh yeah,
so, yeah. Those things are fun. I when I got my smartphone, that's the first thing
first
I downloaded.
Thing using,
that's the first thing I downloaded was my QR code. Yeah, yeah. And then sometimes they're so disappointing because they really don't give you much information. Sometimes it's an advertising source. Admission is $1. Children under 12 are free. There's 4,800 square feet of children's activities going on this year, and they have. From what I understand, they've really put on some neat stuff last year that was really cool. They had all kinds of little craft things and just educational stuff. Please leave your pets at home. Don't get over there and realize that they're not going to let you bring your pet in, because trying to park, of course, is always an issue. And if you spend 20 minutes trying to get a decent parking place and then they tell you that, I'm sorry, Fluffy and Fido are not allowed, you're going to be upset because you're not going to leave. the dogs are fluffies too.
Oh, okay.
Or a cat, yeah. They're not allowed. And that's for their safety as well as the safety of the customers, the visitors there. And for your convenience, there will be two ATMs on site. So don't worry if you didn't bring enough cash.
We cannot use Bitcoins yet, right?
Yeah, no Bitcoins yet. But you know what? I bet you there's some of those folks who have the scanners on their phones.
Oh, yeah.
Because I've been to events where, I've charged an item right there.
Yeah, it's amazing.
And it's pretty cool because I get home and there's my email receipt right there. Boom. In an instant. So
it's amazing,
real nice. So, but yeah, that's some things to look forward to. And again, the 4-H kids will be there to do the plant, the plant pickup. They'll follow you around. They work for tips. These kids do a great job. That tip money helps them to go sometimes to camp. It helps to pay for some of their other animal projects that they're working on for the spring, for the youth fair, which again, the youth fair is also coming up. I want to say I saw the calendar said, I'm going to look at my calendar real quick. The 23rd, I believe, is when it begins. Call over to Extension and find out if you're interested. And that is also over at the Livestock Pavilion is where the Southeastern Youth Fair is. Those kids put forth a lot of hard work in the projects that they do, anywhere from home economics and home crafts. I believe now there's artwork, some stuff, I believe, into digital technologies nowadays, because that's some of the artworks that are coming out nowadays are within the computer system. And then, of course, all their livestock and things, all their bunnies and chickens and goats and pigs and cows and showmanship and all of that. And so give these kids, these are good kids in our community and they deserve our support.
Did I tell you I had a mouse?
You had a mouse?
Well, I think I had two.
Okay.
I got one.
You got one. Well, let's hope you got.
So I had this new kind of a mouse trap I found in Publix.
Okay.
It looks like an igloo.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Have you seen it?
Yeah. They go in and the little door shuts behind them or something.
Well, it slams them against the wall. It lifts them up and.
Whoa.
Yeah, it's just guaranteed to kill. So I wasn't sure I got one because it's kind of enclosed.
Right.
I picked it up and I saw the tail.
Oh.
I said, oh, I got him. Okay. So I had a second one up. Thinking, well, maybe I have more than one.
Right.
And I found little mouse turds around it. So okay. I said, oh, I do have another one.
Yeah.
He just didn't go in yet because right. I could see it was still triggered.
Right.
But then I looked in there and I saw some turds in there and I saw the peanut butter gone. So I said, wow, the thing got in there and didn't trigger it.
Wow. Might have been too little.
You think? A little tiny mouse?
Maybe. Maybe.
See, the problem is I just don't like killing things.
Yeah. Well, it was just as something funny, not really garden related. My daughter, who she's a single parent, my wonderful grandson, she had a great Valentine's Day. Her son made her a handmade, hand-colored Valentine, and I gave her a chocolate heart with Rolos, one of her favorite candies, and her cat brought her a mouse, or dead rat.
That's kind of funny.
Yeah, like the cat brought in a gift as well, and it's like, gee, thanks.
So well, let me ask you something. Your cat brings in you a dead rat. Do you have a different reaction than if your cat brings you in a guinea pig? Do you have a different
actually,
reaction?
He probably wouldn't kill the guinea pig. Well, he does bring her in live items and dead items. Yeah.
But, so I mean, would you be more upset? Because I think people are more...
Yeah, when you bring a bunny in?
Yeah.
Yeah, when they bring the bunny in?
Why'd you kill the bunny?
Or you come home and you find only half of it?
Why'd you kill that? It's a bunny rabbit. Oh, would you kill the rat? Thank goodness you killed it. Yeah.
Got rid of that one. Well, because one is vermin and one is cute. It's the whole thing. What's the difference between a squirrel and a rat? Squirrel has better PR.
Yeah.
He's got a better PR agent.
I had to think about that. I don't know what you meant.
Yeah. Public relations. That, and he has a cuter costume. He's got the fuzzy tail.
Well, cute wins in every category.
That's it. I know we're running all our time.
Even a frog is cuter than a roach.
Oh, most definitely.
So between the two, you will kill the roach before that you kill the frog.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Even if it is a Cuban tree frog.
Well, they are cute. I like those.
They're kind of...
I wouldn't kill that.
I have.
You have? Yeah. See, I see
you
them
You take
on...
them and you put them in a baggie, you throw them in the freezer.
Oh.
And then you throw them in the garbage lifter.
Oh, no. Yeah. They're still alive, though, aren't they? No?
Yeah.
You're not sure?
Could be. No, probably not. Why don't you put them in the baggie, zip the baggie up, then throw them in the freezer. But no, great.
Put him in the blender, then you know he's dead.
No, because then you have to have a different blender for your smoothies. Yeah. But no, good time. We're starting to come into spring. Hold on to your fertilizer things. I know I was just talking about the Bermuda grass. Try to get back on the lawns and landscape and the rest of it. Don't put your fertilizers down yet. If you had a problem with crabgrass last year or previously, if you didn't get any crabgrass stuff down here, fingers in my eyes, go ahead and put it down now. And usually I usually recommend the 1st of February and the middle of March. But if you had crabgrass, go ahead and put something down for it now. If you need to treat for weeds in your lawn, don't do the weed and feed. Treat for the weeds now. Feed when it's time to feed them. And you say the phone's ringing?
Yes, I did. I did. I wasn't trying to interrupt you, though.
No, it's all right.
Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Good morning.
Well, I guess not.
No. I guess I was running my mouth too much, but with I know they have the weed and feeds out there and such like that, but don't. I'm not a big fan. Do the weed control now. Another 6 weeks. Put the feed down.
And you do have a phone call now. Okay. Good morning. You're on there with Carol Ann.
Oh, hi, Carol Ann.
Yeah.
I have one quick question for you. We have some wadilla, and for some reason underneath it, it's getting all this green slimy stuff, and then the wadilla dies out in that area.
Right.
And I don't know what that is.
What the green slimy stuff is, or why it's probably what they call green slime. In landscaped areas, that's kind of hard to do, because usually trying to put any of the, it's like an algae type thing, and it could be with how wet of winter we had. It's just the ground is saturated and just allowing for that to grow, and because it's coming up underneath, it's shading that and then, you know, making it, you know, keeping it even more moist, causing that algae to bloom more and keep growing. I don't really know what you can do, because I don't think there's anything you can really spray upon it that's going to knock it out. You might try... Okay. Go ahead.
So maybe just make sure we don't water in that area when we're watering until we know that the ground's dry enough there.
Right. Because right now you almost shouldn't need water on the landscape. We're getting so much of it.
Well, this has been going on for a couple of months, actually. I just haven't been able to call in to you about it. So we really haven't watered except what the rain has brought us.
Right.
So there's nothing you think that we could, you know, sprinkle on or whatever that might kill that without killing out the wadilla more?
I'm not sure if a copper spray would work on that. I know they have, like, moss and algae agents, but I would have to read the directions on that they have one that you can use. It can be used on grass, on driveways, and things like that, but whether or not it can be used in that situation, I'm not sure.
Okay, all right. We just haven't seen it before and thought it was something unusual.
Right.
Well, thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Uh-huh. Bye-bye. Yeah, some of those algae things, and again, like last week we were saying, you know, because David Holmes had done that article of how wet we've been, and we just, you know, you can't dry your yard out. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah, right.
Sometimes if you find out this year that, wow, with all that extra rain this winter, this one area is staying wet, it could be, okay, I'm going to possibly re-landscape an area and raise it. You can do that. But if it's something, you know, you don't have that option to change that grade any, not much you can really do on driveways and hard areas.
What was that product you had, you would talk about one time, Would get the wet area not so wet and the dry area wet? What was it again?
Remember
Stop the Fire?
Yeah, the Hydratane. The Hydratane product was one that you can treat your yard that or landscape with that's supposed to help regulate the water that's available in the soil in a natural way.
So would that
natural way.
Apply to what you're talking about?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure if that would help or not in that kind of situation. She could try just maybe adding a little bit of sand underneath there just to help dry that out and make it a little more porous. But when you've got something like a ground cover growing over there, it's kind of hard to to really do anything with that. But if it's killing it off, but the product I was thinking about that she might look at would be a, it's called moss and algae control. And I know it can be used on roofs. It can be used on decks and things like that. We'll just have to read the label. Maybe if I get a chance this week, I'll take a look at it when I'm at work and see what it says. Because I know with some of it, you need to rinse it off quickly. You don't want it to sit on shrubs, but you know, certain plants are more sensitive than others.
Moss and algae control.
Yeah. To control.
Sounds like a comedy team. Wasn't there a comedy
moss
team?
Moss and algae?
Ross and Allen or something like that?
Oh. Moss and algae, Ross and...
Something like that.
I don't know. On that one, but no. So just you know, I'll read the label and see whether or not.
By the way, earlier we were talking about the fastest growing plant,
right?
And I won't blow what I'm going to use for my trivia question today. By the way, we have not only a gift certificate to. Do we even have a Bob Wines?
I don't know. I know she brought the donuts.
Oh, so we only have the donuts one today.
Okay.
Okay, so we have donut tickets. Okay, from Doughboys.
Doughboys donuts here in the mall.
Oh, we do?
No.
No, okay. Okay. Thank you, Robin. Anyway, so I was looking up the fastest growing plants, and it's not the fastest, but it's one of the fastest, is algae.
Yeah.
Algae is one of the fastest growing plants. In fact, it's the third.
Third fastest growing. Yeah. Wow. I know it's a quick grower when you get it going, and it just keeps multiplying. But I think you can kill off algae pretty quick, usually if you can get the area dry. If you can change the conditions.
Yeah.
And that way, it you know, you can...
So algae is a plant in... My goodness, I'm trying to... So you get algae in your fish tank, let's say.
Right.
That's literally a plant. If you didn't if you didn't get rid of it...
It would eventually overtake it.
What would it become?
Just a
seaweed?
Mass of string algae. There's different kinds of algae.
Really?
The red algae blooms in salt water and things that cause fish kills and things like that where they
wipe out
the
oxygen. But they don't become really big plants.
Well, the algae bloom, it covers quite a large area. And the string algae,
it's like a hedge.
I've gotten string algae.
It's not really one plant. It's lots of plants, right?
I've gotten string algae in my pond at times, and it is long and...
Like seaweed?
Kind of. It's just kind of slimy. Algae. It's gooey.
And I guess I've always known it was a plant, but I never thought
never
of it in
realized
terms of it.
As it being a plant, right.
Right.
It just sort of
I knew it was.
Doesn't mean,
if you asked me, if I was on Jeopardy, I'd probably get it right.
You might. What is algae? What is a plant?
Right. But I just can't imagine it growing
on the ground, and there's different.
So seaweed
kinds.
Is a
seaweed's seaweed. A weed. Okay. Seaweed's a plant. Luckily, we don't have to worry about growing seaweed here, and usually anything controlled in lakes and stuff is left up to wildlife management.
Did I tell you the Chinese guy at Publix was trying to get me to sample some sushi?
Oh no! Did you try some?
Nope. He said, "What's in it?" He said. Celery, rice, eel sauce, and cucumber. I said, wait a minute. What was that third thing?
Eel sauce?
What is eel sauce? Eel sauce. You know, eel sauce.
But actually,
he showed me a jar of eel sauce.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, thank you.
Sushi's good.
You like eel sauce?
I don't know if I've had eel sauce.
It's in it.
I know wasabi and all that. I have a friend at work. She and her husband will make up.
Really?
Sushi and
has it got raw fish
in
it?
I get the text. I've got sushi, and so yes, we all have lunch together.
Really? Why do you like it so much? It looks horrible.
It's mostly rice.
But do you like it?
Yeah.
What does it taste like?
Tastes like rice and salmon and
salmon, but is it cooked
wasabi?
Salmon?
No, it's raw, real fine.
It's raw. Oh
it's
boy,
real fine, thin slice.
This is the problem.
And some
for
of
me.
It has the some of the ones she does has the like the fake crab stuff. Imitation crab.
Robin loves that stuff, but it's not raw.
No, because that's processed, you know, kind of stuff.
See,
she does tuna.
Tuna,
salmon,
like I would get
raw
tuna. Is
raw
it raw?
Yeah, raw tuna.
Wait a minute.
Raw salmon.
Am I eating raw fish?
When
from,
you eat canned
from the Starkist? No.
Yeah. No.
That's cooked.
That's processed, right?
Okay.
But.
Okay, you do have a phone call. Yeah. By the way, good morning. You on the air with Carol Ann?
Oh no, Larry, this call's for you.
Oh no. You like sushi?
Yeah, and you know it's not all raw. There's a California roll that is vegetables. It's no fish in it, it's rice.
Eel sauce.
Most,
No, eel sauce.
That's what the guy told me.
And eel sauce, probably not eel. It's just what they call it.
That's it.
Oh, it's on the label.
I know it says eel sauce.
Well, I was going to say, do you use Worcestershire?
Yeah, I did.
Do you know it has anchovies in it?
No, I did not.
Yeah, see?
Oh, I did not know that. Is that right?
Yes.
There's a lot of sushi that's really cooked. It's not raw. I think sashimi is the raw. Sushi is not necessarily raw.
Right, and it's not necessarily have any fish in it sometimes.
Okay, you're on a desert island. You have a choice between a charbroiled hamburger and a bowl of sushi. Which do you pick?
I would pick the burger in a hurry, but I'll eat that first. I'll eat the sushi next.
And actually, if you get the tuna tataki, which is a seared tuna, it tastes like steak. It's fabulous.
Yeah. So.
Well, I like tuna.
Yeah.
But it's not raw. I don't want raw.
I'll try tuna tataki. It's seared on the outside. Try it.
Seared on the outside means raw on the inside.
It's just pink.
Be brave, Larry. Come on, man.
I'm really not brave when it comes to food. Eel sauce. That's all I need to know. Eel sauce. No, thank you.
I'll have to bring in a tin of spiced octopus.
No. I don't like anything with, suckers
on
it.
Tentacles
on
the end of it.
Thank you. We had that at Harry's. Yeah. They had that deep fried.
Oh, calamari. Ooh, that's
you like
good.
It? Yeah. See, I don't understand how you like it.
It's good.
If the whole world had my tastes, nobody would be eating any of that stuff.
You'd be having hot dogs and bologna, huh?
Well, hamburgers. Not just hot dogs and bologna. There'd be hamburgers thrown in there, too.
A little French fry with it.
And donuts. I throw donuts in there. All right, we got two $5 gift cards for Doughboy's Mini Donuts.
Okay.
That'll go to the person who answers the question of the day.
All right.
Now, I am not going to ask what the fastest growing plant is, because I think you all know it's bamboo. Did you know that the fastest growing bamboo, according to Guinness, is 4 feet in one day? Bless you.
No.
Bless you. So you touched your eye. No. You got my disease.
No, I got allergies.
4 feet in one day.
Wow.
Have you ever heard that? So the question is not about the fastest growing. It is about the fastest expanding tree. In other words, the one that gains the most rings
the most
in the
girth.
Shortest amount of times. Yeah, girth. Yeah.
Wow.
What tree gets the
rings
biggest. The quickest of any tree?
I know my guess.
So they don't get taller. They might get taller. Well, I don't know.
But it gets bigger around.
So we're looking for the name. And if you give me a call at 622-9622, you get $10 worth of donuts from Doughboy's Mini Donuts here in the Paddock Mall. Let me give you a couple of hints here. In the 1970s, researchers calculated that one of these trees was, in fact, the fastest growing single tree specimen in the world.
Wow.
Having expanded its trunk by 3 inches in the previous 40 years. 3 inches in 40 years, I guess, is very, very fast.
Yeah, I guess. Do they grow in California?
They do grow in California.
Okay, there's a good hint.
That's a very good hint. Let's see.
And they are really big.
For a tree exceeding 30 feet in diameter, that amounts to, the equivalent of a sapling sprouting from scratch into a 50-foot high tree in 1 year.
Wow.
Yeah, that's the equivalent of that. So what tree are we looking for? Looking for the name of a tree. You can give me the... Actually, has a nickname where you can give me the actual name.
Is it one, too, that they have a... They put a road through
one? There is one that has a road going through it, yes.
So if people don't know that one... I mean, it's a famous tree.
It's a famous tree.
It is a very famous tree.
And it is on my bucket list. I want to see these trees. Have you seen these?
No, not except for pictures.
See, me too.
Yeah.
I need to get out.
I'm not well traveled.
I'm in this room too much.
I'm not well traveled.
I thought I'd be happy when I got out of the other room and into this room.
But you got a bigger... Well, no, your window's no bigger. Cause
no, the window is bigger in the other place. This one has more women on the other side of it. That's the only good thing.
Sunnier area, brighter.
All right, I'll have to tell you because nobody's answering.
That's crazy.
You know what it is.
Yeah.
What is it?
It's a giant sequoia.
Giant sequoia, specifically the one they call General Sherman.
Oh, okay. Well, General Sherman is just, yeah.
All right, so now I'm just going to take a call at random and give away these two donut cards. Right?
Somebody, yeah.
Come on, you don't have to answer. We answered for you. You've got the donut coupon.
Oh, who's the redwood tree, the sequoia? Yeah.
Yes, you got it. Very good. Exactly. Who's this?
This is Susan.
Hiya, Susan. How you doing?
Good.
You got donuts from Doughboys.
You got mini donuts.
Good.
And if you have a choice between sushi and these donuts, pick the donuts.
I like sushi.
Well,
one day we'll get it.
I really want you to answer me honestly, though. Which tastes better, the donut or the sushi?
Sushi.
Really? Better than donuts?
Mm.
That's hard to believe. All right. Did you tell me your name? What's your name again?
Susan.
Okay, I was mixing up sushi with Susan. All right. Yeah. You've got two $5 cards here waiting for you.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Susan. All right.
Bye-bye.
Carolyn, thank you.
Another great day. Everybody enjoy this sunshine, beautiful weather.
Beautiful
get out
day.
There and play in the
do something
play
garden-y.
In the dirt if you can.
Garden-ish.
I'm going to try to do some more today. All right.
Don't do your taxes all day.
No, they won't take long.
Just use one of those computer programs.
TurboTax.
Yeah, you'll get it done in no time.
Get it done in about 10, 15 minutes.
I bet you will. All right, we'll take a little break and be right back.
Have a good day. I learned my lesson well. You see, you can't please
everyone, so you got to please yourself. WOCA. AM 1370. 96.3. 96.3. FM. This weather brought to you by...